Hello everyone, and thank you so much for coming. I want to thank the Michelin family, in particular Eugenio and Gisela, for sponsoring this webinar, Gori Cortini for conceiving and organizing it, and the Academy of Dentistry, the people of Umberto and Stefano Campanella for its realization. The topic I will discuss today is very broad, so I will try to summarize and address only the most important and innovative clinical and research topics. I have been collaborating with Miserion for 26 years, during which I developed the Enamel Plus composite system. In all these years, I have dedicated myself to studying and researching to improve materials and restoration techniques. The material that I will present is entirely original and is the result of 40 years of study, research, and work in my clinic, and therefore it is covered by copyright. Even the background music to the videos are composed, played, and produced by the author. It is forbidden to copy, reproduce, distribute, and publish any content without authorization of the author. Today, we will start speaking of posterior restoration. We can say that today composite is considered the official material, the successor of the amalgam for conservative therapy of the posterior sector. The composite material is notably improved, and not only from the aesthetic point of view, but above all from the biomechanical and functional one, and from the functional point of view, it offers many advantages compared to ceramic system. On the market, there are many composite materials. Unfortunately, many of these materials have become obsolete and do not have adequate mechanical characteristics for the real sectors. Unfortunately, many dentists rely only on market information, then often does not correspond to the real characteristic of the material and continue to unknowingly use composites that are not state of the art and are not suitable for restoration in the posterior areas.
Quindi hai partecipato a non si
Sì.
No, no, non ci vedo e non ci
Mi stanno vedendo i partecipanti? Pronto?
sì, la vediamo, professore.
I partecipanti mi vedono?
Sì, vediamo lei e vediamo la presentazione.
Perché noi non ci vediamo qui sul quello degli ospiti, non vediamo niente.
Sarà probabilmente da selezionare il gruppo completo.
In this article, we have the classification of the restorative materials, and we have seven families. In the first one, there are conventional composites. And in the last one, the glazenomer cement or resin modified glazenomer cements. In my restoration, I only consider the first family, and the right name of this material is micro nano hybrid. And in the last one, the glazenomer cement that used like base and like cement for cementing crowns. And I consider the other families like materials of second choice. And what I think it corresponds also what they say the international literature. So when choosing a material for posterior restoration, we have to consider the biocompatibility and the biomechanical characteristic. And we have to consider these two arguments like the first one. The hardness, the abrasion range, and the resilience of the material must be close to those of the natural enamel, otherwise, neuromuscular disorders are created. So, neuromuscular disorders associated with dental malocclusion are widely demonstrated and described in the literature and must be considered as brain dysfunctions that influence and severally test the the neuroplasticity of the cerebral cortex. Neuromuscular disorders is also determined by materials that have a resilience and an abrasion range far from those of natural enamel. If the material is rigid and hard, but does not have adequate thinness, it breaks. Tenacity is the ability of a material to absorb energy and to deform plastically before breaking. Feldspathic ceramics, lithium disilicate, Lyrite and monolithic zirconia have a lower thickness than gold, do not adapt adequately to stress, and often break. So we can say that the clinical-based evidence is very different from literature-based evidence. The slide shows the composition, mechanical characteristics, and indication for the use of tetragonal, cubic, zirconia, and lithium disilicate. All these materials have insufficient thickness and resilience with respect to their hardness. Therefore, they are not able to absorb and adapt to occlusal stress and over time are at risk of fracture. In this research, Tom Nim, the chemist I have been working with for 26 years, and his team has shown that polymer-based CAD-CAM materials have a superior resilience and thickness to zirconia, lithium disilicate, polymer infiltrated ceramic, and feldspathic ceramic. And he demonstrated that gold is the best material from the point of view of absorbing stress, and the modulus of thickness and elastic recovery are very different to the other material. And we know this for a long time. But from an energy dissipation capacity point of view, polymer-based CAD-CAM restorative materials seem to be clinically promising, with considerable robustness and potential for improvement for additional indication. 4 years with Professor Camillo Arcangelo and his team at the University of Chieti, with Dr. Tom Nim of Justus Liebig University, and with the chemist of Enamel Plus team, we have been studying the abrasion of restoration materials and their biomechanical characteristics. In 2014, we developed the Enamel Plus function enamels, which have excellent mechanical characteristics and wear range. In this publication, you can see that HRI function behavior are very, very close to the one of AuroCast noble metal, it's a gold type 3, and very close to human enamel 1, both from the point of view of the volumetric wear and from the point of view of the vertical wear. From this extensive research, we have confirmed that type 3 gold, from the point of view of abrasion, is the material closest to the mechanical characteristic of natural enamel, and which demonstrates high resilience. We see a detail of the wear pit of a gold surface on the left of my slide, and a composite one on the right. Gold adapts with a browning effect, while the composite and ceramic wear out by microfracturing, microchipping, and we usually, in the failure of this material, we used to see this microchipping or cracking. Here we see a case of rehabilitation of the posterior sector with a direct technique with Enamel Plus function. The preparations are ultra conservative and the inlays have very thin thickness in some areas. Thickness that we cannot afford with feldspathic ceramic or with disilicate, because these can get too fragile. This is one of the advantages offered by the composite. We can use different thickness in different areas, while if you use ceramic, disease can create a stressed area. You see the final result after the cementation of the inlay and onlays. And here we see the completed rehabilitation. Undial composite in the posterior sector and adhesive crowns in lithium disilicate from canine to canine as the elements had completely lost the palatine enamel and they were very compromised. So I use composite in an indirect technique in the posterior and lithium disilicate in the anterior. We also studied the wear of ceramic system in relation to that of natural enamel gold. This is another article we published. I have been using lithium disilicate for years. And in my experience, I have found that in the ultra-conservative adhesive techniques, in the posterior sector, when we produce inlays, onlays, overlays, compared to the composite, it presents more problems and difficulties of clinical use. Is very difficult to manage, as well as realization times and cost more high for ceramic. The composite is cheaper. Here we see a rehabilitation of a patient suffering from worn dentition. Perform this rehabilitation with adhesive technique using lithium disilicate. You see the preparation. Very conservative preparation. I only remove the old fillings. And these are the overlays and the inlays in lithium disilicate. I don't use only composite. I use all the material with my technician so I can have the experience to try the different technique, the different material. And I can say that lithium disilicate and feldspathic ceramic are very difficult to manage and they need more time in their application. You see the final result and these works made by my dental technician Mario Zangarini. We also studied the behavior of materials toward the antagonist and vice versa. In this study, tetragonal monolithic zirconia demonstrated the lowest abrasion values compared to gold, feldspathic ceramic, lithium disilicate, and post-polymerized composite. As for the composite, the best performance of the material in terms of abrasion is obtained when the antagonist is natural enamel or the same composite material. In this situation, the post-polymerized composite demonstrates a range of abrasion similar to that of natural enamel. Therefore, when we perform large restoration, we must always consider the antagonist. This is a very important concept. We have to consider the type of antagonist we have. We see here a rehabilitation of the posterior sector with a minimally invasive adhesive technique and overlay in enamel function. The antagonist are natural teeth, therefore ideal for the composite. The case just treated, and I show you a follow-up. This is a 10-year follow-up after only a repolishing with salt and aluminum oxide that we use always when the patient came to our surgery for the oral professional hygiene. You see that the surface of this restoration after 10 years are perfect. And this is because we have, like antagonist, the natural enamel. Natural enamel works very well with undirect composite. In addition to function and biomechanics, we have considered and studied also biocompatibility. We know from the literature that bisphenol and other fluid comonomers such as EMA, containing the organic matrix of mass composites, are cytotoxic. Furthermore, an incomplete polymerization favors the release into the oral environment of these monomers. And I know that a lot of dentists, they use to cure with very reduced timing. It's important to very well cure the material. In this literature, we find several researches on the toxicity of monomers, and in particular on that of bisphenols. Many government agencies that deal with health are also interested in this. Although we do not yet have precise data on the degree of toxicity and on the monomer levels released by the material, we know that they are potentially toxic. Enamel Plus Biofunction is the latest creation born from Enamel Plus research and does not contain bisphenols and nor other unstable comonomers. So we have a very, very biocompatible material. And we did some tests to evaluate the biocompatibility of the material. In this biocompatibility study carried out at the University of Chieti and in press, in phase of publication, six commercial composites were tested using stem cell cultures, using rat fibroblasts. If we analyze the microscopic images of the crops with the composite samples immersed and compare them to the control image, Enamel Plus Biofunction sample A has demonstrated a high biocompatibility and was found to be the most biocompatible among the tested. The composite C sample, on the other hand, was highly toxic and all the stem cells died immediately and after 14 days. Another factor to consider when talking about the biocompatibility of composites are the nanoparticles that are released into the oral environment following wear. If their diameter is less than 30 nanometers, the free nanoparticles are able to cross the cell membrane and can create problems to the immunitary system. In this study, they demonstrate what I am saying. Biofunction does not contain free nanoparticles, but agglomerations of nanoparticles that have an average diameter greater than 30 nanometers. And therefore are not able to cross the cell membrane. You see, in the image, the power of this material produced by the wear, and when we finishing the material, this power, the particles, there are more than 40 nanometers. So we can say that Enamel Plus Biofunction is a really biocompatible material. Biofunction has a behavior towards abrasion very similar to that of natural enamel. In this study, recently published in Operative Dentistry, we see that the abrasion range of biofunction is similar or even better than that of type 3 gold. You see that Enamel Plus Biofunction has a wear like 0.213-15, while Aurocast 8, it's a gold type 3 is 0.216. And this means that we have a very good material, very close to the behavior of the gold standard of the function that is the gold type 3. Biofunction finds indication for direct class 1, sorry, biofunction finds indication for direct class 1 and 2 for small and medium cavities, for the treatment of erosion, and for ultra-conservative rehabilitation. You see in this case a class 1 direct composite restoration, and we see the rehabilitation now of a case of worn dentition performed with direct no prep technique using Enamel Plus Biofunction. It is an adult patient who has an evident loss of enamel on all dental elements. The patient has a crossbite on the left at the level of the canine. So, before to start with the rehabilitation, we have to eliminate this problem. We treat orthodontically the patient to eliminate the crossbite and the anterior wall. because this makes it impossible to restore in an adequate way this type of patient. The orthodontic therapy made by my Dr. Filippo Cadaredes is my orthodontist. And you see the result after the orthodontic treatment. This is the case after the orthodontic phase. The crossbite has been eliminated, and now we can finally rebuild the destroyed occlusal anatomy and restore in adequate vertical dimension. The surfaces to be treated are sandblasted with aluminium oxide, 30 or 50 microns. Then the sand is carefully removed and the adhesive phase is carried out, and then restored with biofunction enamel. This ultra-conservative rehabilitation must be performed in one session. When I deal with these cases, I schedule a full day appointment. And you see the final result of this upper arch, all made with free enamel. So I treated also the other side, and I also reconstructed the palatine walls and the incisal edges of the upper incisors and canine. At least the case before and after the treatment performed with no prep technique, adhesion and biofunction composite technique. The phase of rehabilitation, initial case study, orthodontic, post-orthodontic, and final result. The patient required the aesthetic makeover of this old amalgam restoration, being a complete dial and being class 2 cavities, there is an indication for undial restoration. Let's see the preparation with the build-ups, the impression phase, and the inlays performed in the laboratory by the dental technician. So with this material, it's possible to do these overlay inlays and overlays. And we see the final result. The steps of this case and the final result before and after the treatment. All the inlays and overlays appears very well integrated according to the color matching and also the precision of the models. CAD/CAM technologies is increasingly entering dental offices, is very operator dependent and requires important training. It will surely have more and more importance in the future. However, in many cases, it will lower the quality levels of the final product. And do not expect with these CAD/CAM techniques to obtain the same quality standards in the reconstruction as regards aesthetics in color reproduction, in particular, occlusal relationship and marginal precision. Surely, in the future, we will have even more performing technologies, and surely the future for many reconstructive particle practices will be CAD/CAM. We did some tests on extracted teeth to investigate the marginal precision, and we saw that on the straight margin, we have excellent results, while in the curvature areas, we found important gaps. Here we see the same images. We found an average gap around 150-200 microns. We did measurements in these areas, and I show you the margins. Here we have around 180 micron, 180 micron. And in this area, we have a little bit less and a little bit more, 160, 200. And the aesthetic obtained is not comparable to that of layered restoration with both composite and lithium disilicate. We did another test on an extracted tooth, and our friend Daniele Rondoni, he produced a stratified inlays in composite and two milled inlays using Lava Ultimate and ImageCAD. And we investigate the precision. Here we see the precision obtained with three different techniques: layered composite, milled composite, and milled lithium disilicate. We see that in the stratified composite, we had an average of the precision around 40-50 micron. In the CAD composite, 150-154, and in the CAD lithium disilicate, 79-71 micron. And I can see that the average marginal gap obtained with the well-made layer composite, I repeat, well-made layer, it means that the technician has to work very well, has to be very precise, and this allows you to achieve about 40 microns with stratified composite. To date, however, it is not yet possible with the CAD/CAM technology to obtain the aesthetic and the quality that is obtained with the layering technique. You cannot achieve this type of result only with composite. With the layering is achieved the best integration between light, material, and color. And in this situation, we have the best integration between light, material, and color. The function also works very well in the anterior areas, especially for large class 4 cavities subjected to height stress, such as in the case of a young patient. Biofunction, you see this case, I remove the old fillings, I re-prepare the margin, and you can clearly see the surfaces of these new restoration, very well polished and shiny, a good reproduction of the size of the natural color of the tooth, a balance of polish and fluorescent very close to the natural one. So you can use the biofunction not only for the function, not only for the biocompatibility, but it was very well also for the aesthetic. By applying the technique of the five dimensions color and anatomic layering, we can, with a little practice, reproduce the color of the teeth in a real and very natural way. Here you see a class 4 reconstruction performed on a natural tooth extracted with the biofunction composite. I use this extracted incisor, I create a class 4, and I build the palatal wall, the dentin body use only one dentin, I characterize the margin with amber, I create the polish and use OBN, and I created some intensive with two tonalities, intensive white spot and intensive milky, and then I cover all with the labial enamel. You see the final result in the details with this higher magnification. We can appreciate the details of the restoration, and the polarized images highlight the color dimension that have been accurately reproduced with the biofunction composite masses. You see that you can see all the color dimensions very well reproduced with biofunction and my technique, the anatomic stratification. And now we treat aesthetic restoration in the anterior areas. We will use a class 4 like a guiding chaos. The ultimate goal is to achieve the best aesthetic integration of the restoration with the minimum sacrifice of dental tissues. And you can see the final result. And the patients are very happy when we do this type of work, because we don't have to sacrifice any other tissue, and we can achieve a very good integration. The main clinical steps in this restoration are radiographic documentation, photographic documentation for the study of shape and color, creation of a silicone mask for layering, shape and color determination, cavity preparation, adhesive phases, layering of the composite material, finishing and polishing. These are the main steps in order to achieve a very good integration and a very good aesthetic result. It is important to accurately document cavities, both for medical-legal reasons and for the study of form and color. We will take photographs of the face, dental arches, and individual teeth using different magnification. We will also take black and white photographs for the study of form and polarized photos for the study of color. To better highlight the size of the color, you can increase the contrast of the polarized image. With this technique, the four basic dimensions of the color of the teeth, you have orange, white, red, amber, and their anatomical arrangement can be seen very well. And you can appreciate this dimension, and this may you to reproduce this in a properly way. I spoke about using the polarizator 30 years ago, and I think that this is the best idea I had in my career. The X-ray highlights the pulp status, but it's better always to do a vitality test that can maybe also useful. Always remember that the first objective in this case is the maintenance of pulp vitality. In cases of pulp exposure, it is recommended to always perform a pulp capping, except in cases where there is an evidence of pulp necrosis, and you can feel this through the radiographic signs, negative vitality test. And in this case, you have to devitalize the tooth. In a case that the tooth is vital, I use a layer to do a pulp capping with a layer of calcium hydroxide, and then covered with a glazionomer cement. I use also MTA. In case of extensive fracture, it is recommended to perform a WOXAP on a patient model to build an adequate silicone index. The index must be carefully adapted, cleaned with alcohol, and tested in the mouth. You have to test if it's fitting well before the adhesive phases. In cases of extensive fracture, it is recommended to perform this way. The preparation must be ultra-conservative, where a vestibular mini chamfer and an interproximal and palatine band margin are prepared. Only the enamel should be affected. In my experience, I was able to observe that even a 360 mini chamfer works very well, like in this case. The adhesive phase involves an etching of enamel and dentin for 20 seconds, washing with water and then with 2% cloxidine. After sparing the liquids and drying the cavity with a gentle blow fire, the Nabond adhesive is applied by rubbing it with a micro brush for 1 minute. We need to brush for 1 minute in order that the solvent works very well, the primer works very well with the dentin, blowing to evaporate the solvent and then polymerizing for 1 minute. Enacyl is then applied, blow to spread it in a thin layer and then polymerize for 1 minute. By applying this technique, Enabond is used as if it were a primer, with the advantage that you can polymerize and seal the dentin before applying the fluid resin. Enacyl, which increases the retention, the elasticity of the adhesive phase, and reduces the formation of water streaks. The water streaks are responsible for the aging of the adhesive phase. Once the adhesive phase is completed, the composite begins to be stratified. The palatine wall is created by layering the enamel directly on the mask out of the mouth. Then the mask is placed in the mouth and the material pushed with the brush towards the edge. It is polymerized for 40 seconds because it's very thin. The mask is removed and the interproximal wall is built using the same enamel mass with the help of an acetate matrix. It is polymerized 30 seconds and then the mask is removed. So now we have all the shell made by the enamel. Once the enamel shell is finished, the dentinal body is constructed using a number of dentins in relation to the size and cervical extension of the cavity. Small cavities, one dentin of the same basic chromaticity of the tooth. Medium cavities, two dentins, of which one will have a higher chromaticity. Large cavities, three dentins, on which the third will have a higher chromaticity of the other two. Obviously, the mass chromatic dentins will be stratified first and will occupy the deepest and most cervical area of the cavity. Each layer must be cured individually for 40 seconds. In the incisal part, the mamelons that will determine the shape of the incisal operation must be sculpted. Once the dentin body is completed, the margin is characterized with masses of amber or white or both, depending on the case, and then the free spaces between the mamelons will be filled with blue operation. Once this phase is completed, if required, the intensives are applied using an intensive white mask. Intensive white spot or milk, intensive milking, is depending from the how strong is the effect. Intensive white is the less is not so strong. Intensive milk is stronger. Intensive white spot stay in the middle of the two ones. Here we see the layering scheme of the dentist in the three cavity situation. In small cavities, I prefer to insert two dentins to have a minimum of chromaticity desaturation. In medium cavity, I use two dentins, and in the last one, I use three different chromaticities. But it's important that the last layer we put in the incisal area has to be less chromatic than the other one. The last layer is that of the vestibular enamel that will completely cover all the other layers. It is cured for at least 1 minute, is the last polymerization, and it is passed to the finishing phase, trying to better define the macro and micro texture using 40 micron blades and carborundum stones. It is subsequently polished with diamond paste and the gold airbrush. The final polishing is obtained with salt and aluminum sand. Here you can see the final result from the vestibular and the palatal side. And let's look at the case before and after the treatment. You see that we have a very good core match and also a very good seal according to the integration for the point of view of the biocompatibility. We have a good dentinal, a good crown seal. The smile aspect presents itself with a natural and well-integrated incisal contouring at high magnification and with the polarized imaging, we can appreciate the color dimensions that accurately reproduce the anatomy of the natural tooth color. And you can see all the natural dimension I reproduce in the restoration. Understanding and determining color is certainly the most important factor in aesthetic reconstructive dentistry. Soon, I will hold a 4-hour webinar only on color and how to reproduce color with composites, ceramic, all types of ceramic, and zirconia. It's very important because the aesthetic starts from the color. If you understand the color, you understand how to reproduce the color, and you have to know the possibility you have with all the material, and you have to know the characteristic of the materials. This is very, very important. In the last 19 years in dentistry, shade guides have changed, and then we use spectrophotometers and some software for digital color determination, but the results have always been discouraging, as all these methods are based on an old and inadequate color theory, the theory of the three dimension by Mansell, that considers only three dimensions of color, euchroma and value, while in human teeth we have other dimensions that are very, very important. If we carefully observe and study the color of the teeth, we realize that there are more dimensions that make up the natural color. Dentists and dental technicians did not have a method for identifying and reproducing important details that primarily affected the incisal third, like those you see here. You see that we have more than three dimensions, you value and color. And so it is impossible to determine the color using the color shade guide from the marketing. So in 2001, I published together with my friend Francesco Mangani an evolution of the three color dimension, and I introduced in dentistry the five color dimension, where I think view and chroma in a single dimension called chromaticity, and I introduced three new dimensions that from the point of view of the clinical result are of great importance: intensive, opalescent, and characterization. I also produce a color shade guide, you see in the slide, and we published this in this article and in my book in 2003 with Francesco Mangani and my wife Olga Klimoskaya. I propose a color chart dedicated to the five color dimensions with the classification of the three new color dimensions: intensive, opalescent, and characterization, which you see on the left, while on the right we have the composite reproduction of the different situations depicted on the color chart. You have to try to reproduce this situation on some models, and you have to simulate with the composite this situation. It's important if you want to learn how to do in a natural way in the mouth of the patient. Over the past 15 years, the Department of Medical, Oral and Biotechnological Sciences of the University D'Annunzio of Chieti, directed by my friend Professor Camillo D'Arcangelo, has been hosting the Jules Allman Trophy, European Scholarship Competition for Final Year Dentistry Student, conceived and organized by Jana Dastalova, Marketing Manager of Mycerium. This is a scholarship sponsored by Mycerium, and it is dedicated to the five color dimension and the anatomical stratification I published. 88 European universities teach the technique of the five color dimension and the anatomic stratification of Dr. Lorenzo Vanini. We will not talk about the dimension of the intensive, an element which I consider to be very important in the reproduction of the natural color of the teeth and in the aesthetic integration of the restoration. Now I want to speak about the intensive, because I through that, these are very important. Intensive are present and very evident, especially in the teeth of young people. The presence of and creation of the intensive can be very useful for obtaining a good margin integration, especially in presence of an oblique margin that is more difficult to mask. In effect, when we have this oblique margin, it's very difficult to eliminate the black line. And an horizontal margin, it's easier to manage and to mask and integrate than an oblique one. In these cases, the horizontal intensive helps a lot by interrupting the horizontal gray line that often forms on the margin. and you see the good integration we can achieve. In these cases, the intensive create a leopard spot effect, which helps to camouflage the margin. In the following clip, we will observe how the intensive are created with layering. In the case shown, we are treating a cavity with an oblique margin, therefore difficult to integrate, so we resort to the intensives already very present in the natural color of this element to better integrate and camouflage the margin. Let's see this video now. In this video, we can see how the intensives are created with layering. In this case, we are treating a cavity with an oblique margin, therefore difficult to integrate, so we resort to the intensive, already very present in the natural color of this element. And we want to recreate this. Before we create the parietal shell of enamel, and then we start with the dentin body. We start with the dentin chromaticity of 3, and we fill the deepest part of the cavity with this dentin. I am doing this with a steel spatula, and then I have to desaturate with UD1. I cure. The next step is to characterize the margin with white. I use intensive white spot. And you only have to recontour in the margin. And the goal is to recreate this white effect you see also in the other tooth. It's always intensive white spot. Intensive white spot is not so strong with it like intensive milky. And it was well in this situation. After this, I put the vestibular enamel. I use enamel 2, is medium value. You have to stratify very well this with the brush. The brush has to be dry. I don't use any bonding. And before to cure, I sculpt this horizontal growth with the blade. I use for this, I use a beaver, and then I will fill this growth with a mass that have some more white than this material. So I cure, and instead to use intensive white spot that is too strong in this area, I will use enamel 3 that is more white than you do, and create this very, very delicate effect. I feel very well the material, and then I cure. You see that in the intertroxial area, we have some more in the transition line, we have a little bit more white. So now after curing this material, I will stratify a very delicate layer of intensive white spot. I need to increase the white in this area. You have to use this in homeopathic doses, very, very thin. In the transition line, we need to have a little bit more thinness of enamel. And then I put another thin layer of UA2, because I want to harmonize very well this new white. You have to stratify very well. And when you have the right shape, you can cure. 1 minute, and then we start with the finishing phase using strips, using different type of burr, but usually I use burr 40 micron diamond burr, like this one, to create the macro texture. And for the palatal side, I use an olive shape 40 micron burr For the horizontal texture, I use this green stone. It works very well in this situation. And then we start with the polishing phase, using this rubber point. And then brush. This is air gold brush with diamond plus 3 micron. Then air gold brush with 1 micron diamond pass, and at least a felt with aluminum side that get a very brilliance to the surface. I remove the rubber then. And after the hydration of the tissues, the enamel, you see the final result 1 day later. You see how the white helps a lot the integration and the color matching before and after the treatment. And I think that the intensities are very important and can help a lot in this situation. So this is one of the new dimensions I introduce in dentistry. Another important dimension is the opalescence that arises from the enamel and is more evident in the areas of free enamel and is called the incisal area. It is necessary to learn how to observe the teeth carefully in order to learn how to identify the internal shape of the opalescence and then to be able to reproduce this situation in the stratification. This opalescent dimension is very, very important. And now I'll show you how to do. In the teeth, the opalescent phenomena are limited to the middle incisal third at the level of the incisal edge and the interproximal areas, where the free enamel is found. The opalescent phenomena produce gray, blue, and amber shades that create an incisal halo that comes with different shades present in my classification on the color chart. So, in the teeth, the phenomena of opalescence is confined in the incisal third. And when people smile, the incisal third appears more than other areas. So it is important to reproduce this in a natural way. The enamel covers the entire dentinal body like a fibrotic system and has very interesting and complex optical characteristics. The enamel is translucent, and when the light hits and passes through the prism of the enamel, an internal reflection is created which gives rise to the phenomenon of opalescence that occurs in the free enamel in the form of shades ranging from gray to blue to amber. The most difficult thing in a restoration is precisely knowing how to reproduce this opalescence in a natural way without resorting to the use of stains, because the stains, they block, they stop the light. And we need to have an internal reflection if you want to achieve a natural opalescent effect. In this transilluminated natural tooth section, you can appreciate the 4 basic shades that make up the color of the teeth and that they are represented in the 5 color dimension. As can be seen, the opalescent arises mainly from free enamel and is characterized by shades ranging from gray to blue to amber. For many years, I worked with chemists and physicists in collaboration with the Fraunhofer Institute in Dresden, Germany, one of the best optical institutes on an international level, studying the optical characteristics in order to develop masses with translucency and fillers capable of reproducing an opalescent effect similar or close to that of natural enamel. The most difficult challenge is to be able to obtain enamel masses with a high translucency and a high percentage of filler, as modern nanohybrid composite enamels being highly loaded are very opaque and increasing thinness, this material lose translucency and decrease opacity. With our study, we produce HRI that it has a good translucency and without losing fillers, we have a good material for the point of view of the mechanical properties, and then for the translucency and the optical characteristics. The problem with translucent enamel is that the more translucent they are, the more they will lower the value of the restoration. See an example here in this case. The reconstruction is low in value. We now see the new reconstruction where the value translucency problem has been better managed. This case I did on a practical course to a patient that is, she is a colleague, has been in the mouth for 25 years now. We have studied the refractive index of denting and enamel of natural teeth, composites, and ceramics by developing a measurement technique dedicated to human enamel that we published with Van Hoffen Institute in a magazine. And we found that the refraction index of the material you found in the marketing stayed between 1.48 to 1.53, while the refraction index of the natural enamel is 1.62. Our HRI composite, it has this refraction index, 1.62. It's the only material in the world that it has this refraction index. We also studied fluorescence trying to reproduce it in denting enamel in a balanced way and in axis with that of natural teeth. In this test, I reproduced the composite, this natural tooth, in order to compare the fluorescent effect. You see the fluorescent effect on your left side, you have the natural tooth. On the right side, you have the composite, and you see that it's very well balanced of fluorescent in this material. Through rigorous testing and the production of numerous samples, we managed to obtain the following masses with very natural opalescent effects. Amber, opalescent amber, OBN, opalescent blue, natural. And using these masses, you can achieve this natural halo in the incisal third. You see in this reproduction I made with composite that we have a very, very natural halo in the incisal third. The goal was to obtain material capable of behaving optical, such as opal stone, that creates opalescent shades based on the type of incident light and its internal reflection. Here, we don't have any pigments inside, and the effect is arises only from the interaction of the internal reflection with the filters. This is a natural opalescent phenomenon. Here we see a case where the margins are completely reconstructed, and the incisal opalescent is built with a natural aspect. You see before and after, from the palatal side also, and you see the detail in this big magnification. No stain inside, only OBN. The anatomomedullary technique, which I developed and published in 1995, plays a key role in the construction of the incisal halo. So you need the material, but you also need the technique. This is the philosophy of Enamel Plus. This is the Enamel Plus philosophy. We offer the material, but before we offer the technique. In addition to the material layering, the layering also plays a very important role in creating a natural incisal halo. The enamel shell must respect the contour of the natural tooth in shape, and the incisal edge must be aligned as much as possible with that of the contralateral homologous tooth. The shape of the opalescent is determined by the shape of the mamelons, which must be open enough to create a free space that allows light to enter. The free space between the mamelons are then filled with the opalescent mass. And you see in the details this. The characterization of the margin creates the incisal frame that contain and highlights the halo. These characterizations are made with white, intensive white or intensive white spot, and or amber intensive amber. Once the margin has been characterized, the spaces between the mamelons are filled with the blue opalescent mass. The opalescent has to stay only inside these spaces, and it doesn't have to go up of these incisal third. We have to polymerize, and the stratification is completed with the vestibular enamel. If you need some intensive, you have to put before the vestibular enamel, and subsequently we finish in polishing. This is the final result. Here we see the case before and after the treatment, and at greater magnification, the appearance created in the restoration is highlighted in the incisal fur, which is highlighted by the polarized image. You see that we have a very natural effect. And you can see the four tonalities: yellow, orange, white, blue, and amber. You see another case where I created a very, very important and natural incisal arrow, always using this technique. In this video, I show now how to create a very good opalescent effect. This is a very interesting tool where we have a very interesting opalescent halo. The value of this tool is high, and it's very difficult to obtain a high value and also a very good opalescent effect. After we build the dentin body with the mamelons, and the mamelons is determine the shape of the opalescent effect. We have an opalescent effect type 2 with the three mamelons with the mesial one split, and the first step is to recontouring the incisal contour with white. I am characterizing the margin with intensive white. You only have to put a very thin layer, and you only have to recontouring the margin you created with the enamel. You haven't to fill the spaces between the mamelons with the white, because this can get too opaque the situation. And this stops the light. The light has to enter inside between the mammals in this growth. Always intensive white spot. You see that I use this in homeopathic doses, very thin layers. After curing, we are ready to fill these spaces with OBM. This is a very sticky material, and you have to position it is very well inside using a steel spatula and then using a brush. This material has to stay inside. It doesn't to go in the surface and has to be all coated, covered by the enamel. I'm feeling very well the material inside, and when all is okay, I cure. The last layer is the enamel. I use enamel 2 here. The value of HRI is high, and it works well also the UE2 in this case, where the value is quite high. I use different type of brushes, silicone brushes and gold brushes. I'm trying to achieve the final shape, a cure, and this is after the finishing phase and polishing phase. Now I remove the rubber dam. Thank you. After this, you have to rehydrate it in amol. And after the rehydration, you can see the final result. The restoration is very well integrated, but the goal is to achieve a very natural opalescent halo. You can see here the blue around surrounding all the mammals, and we have a very natural effect. I think that this can make the difference in the restoration, because this area appears when the patient is smiling. So we spoke about the opalescent. And now, this morning, some people asked me about the finishing and polishing phases, and I show you what I do. For finishing, I use the diamond burr, and I use this type of diamond burr, 40 or 25 micron for the surface. This is the shape I use. Or you can use also multi-blade burr for the interproximal areas. The shape of these burrs is very good to enter in the interproximal spaces. And I use abrasive strips. You can use metal strip or other type of strip, and you can use these together with the diamond burr. For the macro texture, I use always this type of blade. You can use this multi-blade fan, or you can use diamond burrs like this one. I prefer the diamond burrs. And you can check your work using this varnish that they use the technician in laboratory. This allows you to understand what you did and to have a control of the surface. For the micro texture, I use like first choice the green stone. This works very well in the composite, or we can find in the market the big ceramic burrs. Also these they work well, and you can check with some graphitis, and you can have an idea how is the intensity of your work. And you can do some correction. You can remove, or you can do more strong. This is a control phase. Polishing phase. Silicone rubber point. This is a fantastic rubber point. It's U1. It's permeated with diamond. It works very, very well. And then soft well brush, and I use these air ghost brushes with diamond paste. I start with 3 micron and then with 1 micron. They have different capabilities of abrasion. At least for glossing, I use felt. This is a soft felt disc with aluminium oxide. We use aluminium oxide also for the maintenance, and this can be used also by the hygienist. And in my surgery, the hygienist in the oral professional hygiene use this to re-glossing the surfaces. And you see the final result. Regarding the longevity of the composite restoration, I would like to say that I do not completely agree with what is reported in the literature. That is, the more complex the restoration, the shorter is life. As in my long experience, I have been able to see that this is not always the case, and that in any case, ceramics, especially bonded metal-free ceramics, veneers, ovaries, and crowns, present more problems over time in terms of chipping and cracking than composites, with the difference that while the composite is easily repairable, the ceramics cannot be repaired, and when they are repaired by patching with the composite, The problem reoccurs in short or medium terms. In this case, I have a 15 years follow-up, and you see that after 15 years, we only have a very little chipping in the margin of the first incisor. And this is very easy, it's very easy to repair. This work is often seen in the clinic with modern metal free ceramic system, material that is increasingly aesthetic, but less and less resilient, that is able to absorb stress. And here, too, I have to say that the clinical data is different from that of literature. So someone must be telling lies. Someone must be telling lies. The literature doesn't correspond to the clinic. Let us now look at medium and long-term cases. This is a young patient with class 4 lesions, very extensive on the lateral incisor. The elements are vital and the left central incisor show a dyschromia due to the adenteral hematoma. The cavities are prepared in an ultra-conservative way, without touching the exposed dentin, because I don't want to stress this dentin. In particular, on the lateral, where we have a very deep cavity, and in the first central, where I have an hematoma. So, the elements, for functional reason, have been reconstructed with elemental function, obtaining very resistant restoration, but still with a good aesthetic result. Not only resistant, but also aesthetic. This material is able to offer you also aesthetic. So, look some details, how are the surfaces, and the 5 years checkup does not reveal structural problem or aesthetic problem, and the surfaces appear well preserved and shiny. Look also with eye magnification the quality of these surfaces. Now I show a 12-year follow-up. You see before and after 12 years. The wear of the modern composite is very close to the wear of natural enamel. And the black and white imaging show the loss of texture due to abrasion, and it can be seen that composite and natural enamel have a very similar abrasion. Very well balanced. We see here still a long case term, a full 18 years. The restoration carried out with enamel plus HFO still appear in excellent condition. The surfaces have been periodically polishing with professional hygiene checks using a felt and aluminium oxide only. 18 years. Yet another case, a compressed fracture with pulp espasm, where I also did a direct pulp cupping using MTA in this case. The follow-up at 18 years shows a restoration still in perfect condition, and the tooth has maintained pulp vitality. This case is still in the mouth of the patient. I have to take a new photo, and this follow-up has to be considered like 20 years, not 18 years. 20 years forward. We have reached the end, and the message I want to send you is that to make quality dentistry, it takes passion, study, commitment, time. Dentistry conditioned by the ends of the clock, by doing fast, by doing simple, by doing whiter, and doing more economically, makes us lose quality and takes away the pride and passion for our work. Dentistry must not go down to the local market or mass supermarket, where it is only the lowest price that attracts users. When we have thin abutments, I prefer to have the metal abutment and use the ceramic metal. And I think that we have to reconsider the old technique like metal ceramic. And for example, in these cases, when I do this type of restoration on the implants And when we have a broadband very thin, 3.3, 3.5, we cannot think to do this a broadband with zirconia. It doesn't work. And look the quality we can achieve with the old metal ceramic. Another indication with the traditional technique, I speak about the state of the art, and I think that the state of the art is also to consider the old technique. And look, in this case, I have two lateral with implants. These are abandonment 3.3, and I do metal, a metal abandonment and metal ceramic. We see the temporization, the train of the metal, and the final result. Look how my technician is able to manage this situation. Implant surgery made by Stefano Danelli is my implantist, and the technician is Marco Cossi. We have quality, we have good integration, and we also have aesthetic. Today, it often appears to replay frontal with implants, and this is also a great challenge to attain a good aesthetic result. To overcome this challenge, you need to have a true knowledge of techniques and material. And remember that there are materials, such as metal ceramic, which is in many situations can be successful both in terms of biomechanics and aesthetic. Look at this case. There was a resorption. I have to extract the tooth. And look, this is the situation. I use a metal abandonment. And do it yourself dentistry. This is the trend today that some dentists, they do all with CAD/CAM system in the surgery, does not allow us to obtain excellence. We always need a good dental technician, and we must be careful to retire materials and techniques that have years of clinical experience behind them. We have to be careful to retire materials and techniques that have years of clinical experience behind them. That does not be influenced by fashions, by the messages of Congress showmen, and by marketing. You cannot always think of using metal free, and personally, I have never stopped using metal ceramic in many situations, in particular on implants, even in the aesthetic sector. And you see, we try different types of material. For this case, my technician produced four different types of crowns, using zirconia, using metal ceramic, using stratification, using monolithic, but look, we analyze the color, we analyze the translucency, we analyze all the details. At the end, I cemented metal ceramic. This is a metal ceramic crown made by my technique, Mario Zangarini. And in this case, I can have a good quality, I can have a good integration, and also a very, very good aesthetic. Look at this photo with polarizator. When restoring seriously compromised teeth with discoloration rules, there is an indication for metal ceramic. When you have this type of situation, look, I have to extract one tooth, and on the other tooth, I have this terrible dyschromia. You cannot think to mask this with a metal-free crown. So, some steps of this case, impression, and the two crown. These are metal ceramic, and we use gold, and this is the final result. Look how my technician reproduce the color of these teeth, and look how is the integration. Some details about the integration in the gingival tissues. Also in complex rehabilitation, Also in the complex rehabilitation, when we have implants and we have this disaster for the aesthetic, also for the function, I don't want to have rigid material. We need material that are able to absorb the stress. And this is the message of this lecture. We need to use material that are good for our system, that are tolerate for our neuromuscular system. How you can think to restore this with zirconia is too hard for our system and can create problems to the brain. So some step of this rehabilitation, surgery by Stefano Danelli, my implant surgery, and then the temporalization. This is the situation of the implants. And after this, you see that I restore the incisor using biofunction, or with the adhesive technique, the temporalization of the implants, and look, these are crowns and bridge made with gold and composite biofunction. We have composite biofunction on the implant in the low jaw, and composite with in the Toronto, in the Superior Toronto. This is the final result. And the patient, they changed very, very, very well. Okay, the time over. I thank you for your attention and I greet you, wishing you and your family's health, happiness and prosperity. Thank you again to Micerium and Gori Cotinini, the Academy of Dentists in the People of Umberto and Stefano, they supported me, Campanella, and have a good weekend. Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, Professor Vanini.
Attingo la voce per piacere, Gori, non senti.
Thank you, Professor Vanini, and thank you to all of the clinicians that are connected with us from more than 60 countries all over the world. Please remember, we have recorded this webinar session, and you will all receive a link in order to achieve in seeing it again. And also, if you want to make some questions to Professor Vanini, we're going to write down all the questions, have him answer, and then we will forward you his answers. From the Micerium Group family and from Academy of Dentistry, thank you again for being with us today. Excuse me, there has been a whistle from the Micerium